Words at War presents The Ship.
With 500,000 men in the Royal Navy, it is inevitable that there should be some coincidence of names and ranks between characters in this book and officers and ratings now serving. That is so inevitable that the author has made no attempt to avoid any such coincidence. All he can do is to assure the reader that he has attempted neither portrait nor caricature of any living person.
You'll find that written on one of the front pages of a book I read a few days ago. The Ship by C.S. Forrester. Words at War. The National Broadcasting Company, in cooperation with the Council on Books in Wartime, brings you another in its series of radio adaptations of great books of this war. Each week at this time, we bring you selected dramatic episodes from some of the most stirring of our war-inspired literature. Tonight's story, The Ship, by C.S. Forrester, eminent English author of Captain Horatio Hornblower and other fine books. Adapted for radio by Edmund Bernbrier. The Ship is a glorious yarn about a glorious British vessel and the men aboard her. A novel. Yet as you read it, you feel you're reading facts. It's tough, authentic, gripping, this yarn. I read it and I was excited. I hope you will be too. If the convoy didn't get through, Malta might fall. The convoy had to get through. And there were only these 5 light cruisers and 12 destroyers to get it through. The ship, HMS Artemis, was a light cruiser.
Masthead, smoke in the starboard bow, green 19. Masthead, smoke in the starboard bow, green 19.
Some men would have been uncomfortable in the crow's nest. Not so ordinary seaman Harold Quimsby, whose idea of happiness was a full belly and nothing particular to do. Thanks to many hours of practice, Quimsby was able to watch the whole horizon forward of the beam without allowing any of his automatic movements to break into his inner thoughts. He was thinking now of his first sea voyage back in the almost unbelievably distant days of 1939. He'd been up in the crow's nest then, too, he remembered, when his binoculars picked up a dot on the distant surface, and he'd rung down to the bridge with excitement and seasickness.
There's something over on the left.
Where are you speaking from?
The headmast. Oh, I mean the masthead, sir.
Then that's what you say first, so that we know down here. And you don't say over on the left, do you? What do you say?
On the port bow, sir.
That's right. But it's better to give a bearing. What does your bearing indicator read?
21, sir.
How do you say it?
I've forgotten, sir.
Port is red and starboard is green. Remember that port wine is red, and then you won't forget. And 21 isn't plain enough, is it?
No, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, let's have your report. Remember to say where you're speaking from first.
Masthead, sir. Object in sight. Red, 21.
Very good, Quimsby, but you must say it twice over. You remember being told that. If the guns are firing, we might not hear you the first time.
Yes, sir. Aye, sir.
He'd been a very green hand at that time, this ordinary seaman, Harold Quimsby. He felt uncomfortable all over again as he remembered it. Now he looked attentively at the horizon, blinked, and looked again with his hand on the buzzer of the voice tube.
Fore bridge.
Masthead, smoke in the starboard bow, green 19. Masthead, smoke in the starboard bow, green 19.
Most of the Marines of the HMS Artemis were now on the bridge. Captain and torpedo officer, navigating lieutenant, an officer of the watch, and chief yeoman. They stood there unprotected, even from the weather. Nothing over their heads and less than shoulder high around them. Only the thin plating to keep out the seas when the ship was taking green water over her bows. Death could strike anywhere on that bridge. But then, death could strike anywhere in the whole ship, for the plating of which she was constructed was hardly thicker than paper. Even a machine gun bullet could penetrate it if it struck square. The ship was an eggshell armed with sledgehammers.
Masthead report smoke. Green 19, sir.
Very good. Chief Yeoman, signal that to the flagship.
The captain, replying to his secretary, paymaster, sub-lieutenant James Jerningham, and giving the order to his chief yeoman.
So, that's that.
Just three words. Spoken quietly to himself by Captain the Honorable Miles Ernest Thornton Harrington York. A man of far fewer words than name. However, the economy of his speech belied the torrent of thought that went roaring through his brilliant mind at the first report.
The Italian fleet is out in full force. Difficult to tell how many seaworthy battleships they have after Taranto and Matapan. We'll know now. See them with our own eyes. See them all, because Italians never venture out except in fullest possible force. So, that's that.
He twisted on his stool and looked round him over the bulging sea. There on the port quarter wallowed the convoy, the fat, helpless merchant ships that carried within them the salvation of Malta. Food, new inner tubing for anti-aircraft guns, shells, heavy guns, mountings, and ammunition. The convoy had to get through. And if it were reckless to risk it with such a frail escort, then recklessness must be forgiven.
You can see the smoke now, sir. The flagship signal, sir, letter K.
Acknowledge the flagship signal, Chief Yeoman.
The signal from flagship to port specified that Scheme K would be carried out under the circumstances, with moderate wind abaft and the enemy to leeward. The captain had foreseen these tactics, for already open on his knee were the typewritten orders which laid down what each ship should do under Scheme K.
Signals down, sir.
410. 210 revolutions.
410. 210 revolutions.
The convoy was executing a wheel to port under full helm. The cruisers were turning more gently and increasing speed. And the destroyers in the advance screen were doubling around. It was a beautiful geometrical movement.
Steady. Midships.
Midships.
Then another signal ran to the masthead of the flagship. It fluttered, waiting for acknowledgement, and then went down.
Starboard 10, midships.
Starboard 10, midships.
Forebridge.
Ships in sight. Ships in sight.
Upon getting more complete details from Quimsby aloft, Paymaster Sub-Lieutenant James Jerningham turned to yell the message to the captain.
Six big ships, six destroyers. Two leading ships look like battleships. Might be heavy cruisers. Others are light cruisers.
The captain figured quickly in his mind that if Quimsby could see them now, the enemy ships would be in sight from the bridge in about 4 minutes. The voice of the range taker began its chant.
Range 210, range 205, range 200.
In exactly 4 minutes, the enemy shot up suddenly over the curve of the world, climbing over it with astonishing speed.
Port 15, revolution for 27 knots.
Port 15,
revolutions for 27 knots.
Visibility was at its best. The enemy ships made hard, sharp silhouettes against the blue and gray background. Paymaster Sub-Lieutenant James Jerningham knew himself to be a coward. But some time ago, he made up his mind to be a coward lacking in nothing. He spent hours in his cabin, carefully studying the pictured profiles of hostile ships. Study carried out in a mood of desperation, of despair. And he had a photographic memory which enabled him to recall the very pages on which he had seen those profiles, even the very print beneath them.
The two leading ships are heavy cruisers, Bolzano, sir. 9,000 tons, 8 8-inch guns, 32 knots.
You're sure? Aren't they?
No, sir. And the last three cruisers look like Bandoneri's. I don't know about the first one, though, sir. She's like nothing we've been told about. I suppose she's the new one, Cadorna, and the intelligence people didn't get her Prothia right.
I expect you're right.
I think I am, sir.
Out of 500 who started as naval cadets, only one man ever reached the lofty rank of a captain RN. Only a few grades lower than God. That's the thought Jerningham had at that particular moment. It was followed by another that saved him from some of his bitter feeling of inferiority. He, Jerningham, could spot ships better than his captain. It did not mean he respected the captain less, admired him less. He would have admired him even more if he could have read the captain's cool, unflurried mind.
Out there, six of the best the Italians have. The Vice Admiral's flag on the leader. A Centini, perhaps. A Brigetti. The big 8 inches nearly on range now. Probably open fire any moment. Our sixes couldn't put a shell within 3,000 yards of them now. They know their superior strength. Undoubtedly been informed about it from the air. Possibly that's a screen out there for a stronger force. More heavy cruisers, perhaps, and battleships. Why should they wait for reinforcements? 2 heavy cruisers and 4 light against our 5 light cruisers. If they know their business, they'll turn to port, close with us, and finish us off. If we knew ours, we would run like hares. Let the convoy go. Let Malta go.
Later, the captain's report read,
at 1:30 hours, the enemy opened fire.
It might be worth someone's while to try to analyze why the column of water thrown up by an 8-inch shell should be so beautiful. It possesses a faint yellow tinge, meaning it's of the high explosive type. And it's really a charming sight against sky and sea. They're beautiful to watch as long as they miss. And these powerful, all-destructive 8 inches were all distinct misses, showing that the gunnery control instruments in the Italian ship were not lined up as accurately as they should be. Now the British flagship was leading round to the enemy. That was the way to deal with them. If they won't come out and fight, go in and fight them.
Range 1700!
It was leading seaman Alfred Lightfoot's job to take ranges quickly. That was his personal contribution to the perfect fighting hole, which was the ship. And he did what he was supposed to do without distraction.
Blimey, if a shell's got me name on it, I'll get it, and from no other shell.
21 seconds ago, he'd seen the flashes of the guns at which he was pointing his rangefinder. And already Alfred Lightfoot had forgotten them. During those 21 seconds, those 8-inch shells had been hurtling towards the HMS Artemis, hurtling through the air at a speed of more than a mile in 2 seconds. Their path was curved, reaching far up into the upper atmosphere, higher than the highest Alps, into the freezing stratosphere before plunging downward towards their target. Suddenly, Alfred Lightfoot heard a noise as of rushing water and of tearing sheets. And then the field of his rangefinder was blotted out in an immense upheaval of water as the nearest shell of the broadside pitched close beside the starboard bow of the Artemis. 20 tons of yellowed water came tumbling on board, deluging the upper works, flooding over Lightfoot's rangefinder.
Nine hops, Stuart! Oh! Oh, blimey!
Instantly, training and professional pride mastered him, and he deftly twirled the screws and brought the enemy into focus once again.
Range 1900!
It was then that Paymaster Sub-Lieutenant James Jerningham saw the Italian ships turn away, and he gravely noted the time upon the pad in his lap. Later, the captain's report read,
the enemy withdrew.
Was it a surprise to you they're running away like that?
No, sir. Not very much.
It may just be a trick to get us away from the convoy. Then their planes would have a chance. But I don't think so.
No, sir?
Something bigger than cruisers out today, I fancy. They might be trying to lead us into a trap.
Starboard 15.
Resume previous course.
We're staying between the ITIs and the convoy.
and every minute brings us nearer to Malta.
Jerningham at that point said, yes, sir. He was frantically searching about in his mind for some contribution to make to this conversation other than yes, sir, or no, sir. Wanting to appear bright, he said,
night is coming.
Yes. The Aedis are losing time. The most valuable asset they have, and they're squandering it. The commonest mistake to make in war is to think that because a certain course seems to you to be the best for the enemy, that is the course he will take. He may not think it best. Or there may be some reason against it which you don't know about.
That's true, sir.
This was the longest speech ever heard from the captain.
And the next commonest mistake is to give unnecessary orders. Quipple up there.
Ordinary Seaman Whipple was now climbing the difficult ladder to the crow's nest to relieve Quimsby.
Whipple up there will keep a sharp lookout without my telling him. He knows what he's there for.
Jerningham gaped at him, wordless now in spite of his efforts to appear bright. This was an aspect of the captain's character which he'd never seen before. This courteous gentleman with his smiling common sense and his insight into character. When Whipple took over from Quimsby, aloft,
and that thing in the front of the line is the flagship. Give my regards to the Admiral when you get your commission.
Go on, take your rest.
5 minutes later, there was no kidding around.
Forebridge.
Masthead, more smoke visible on the port bow beyond the enemy cruisers. Red 3-8. Masthead, more smoke visible. Masthead, that lot of new smoke is closing us. Sign Baron. No. Red 3-9. Masthead. Battleship in sight. Two battleships and a Navy cruiser heading a little abaft of our Baron as the other ships are turning now astern of them.
The behavior of the ship's company was most satisfactory.
Another phase of the captain's report. Not one man in 10 in Artemis could see what was going on. In the captain's opinion, distorted news was dangerous.
Go down and tell the ship about the situation.
Aye, aye, sir.
Jerningham's mind was feverishly turning over words and phrases as he descended the ladder. He didn't have time to assemble any, but on the other hand, he didn't have time in those few seconds to become self-conscious, nor had his weakness time to reassert itself.
I've a message for the ship from the captain.
The petty officer beside the loudspeaker hanging on the bulkhead switched on and piped shrilly. The sound of his call audible in every part of the ship.
The captain has sent me to tell you that we've got the entire Aikai Navy in front of us. Battleships, heavy cruisers and all. They've run away from us once, the heavy cruisers have. Now we're going to see if the battleships will run too. 3 hours of daylight left, and the convoy's got to reach Malta. Good luck to us all. There's none like us.
Revolution for 31 knots. Make smoke.
3 minutes of smoke meant a smoke bank a mile and a half long. Far too wide for the enemy to watch with care all along its length. Later, the captain's report...
I found the smoke screen to be extremely effective.
The smoke bank, allowing for spread, would be a quarter of a mile thick. The captain had solved a complex mathematical problem in his head. He turned to the voice tube beside him.
Captain, gunnery officer.
Gunnery officer.
I'm turning to starboard now. It will take us 2 minutes and 10 seconds approximately to go through the smoke. You'll find the Aitai is about red 5 when we come out, but I shall turn to port parallel to their course immediately. Open fire when you are ready. All right?
Yes, sir.
And by guns. Turn 8 points to starboard, quartermaster.
Starboard, 15. Hit it, midship.
Stop making smoke.
And the order went down through 5 decks to stoker Petty Officer Harmsworth in the boiler room. Now the Artemis was heading squarely into the smoke, solidly away to starboard. One moment they were out in that clear sunshine, and the next, they were in reeking, oily darkness.
Call the masthead and see if the lookout is in the smoke.
Masthead reports he's in the smoke and can't see anything, sir.
30 seconds. 55 seconds. 1 minute. 75 seconds. 90 seconds. 105 seconds.
Not long to go now, and the smoke was just as thick as ever. Extremely good.
2 minutes.
The captain could see the navigating lieutenant plainly now, and the Italians could just about see the shadowy gray form of the Artemis emerging from the smoke.
Port 15.
And Artemis, beautiful in the sunshine, swung round to turn her broadside upon the colossal force. Long before the Artemis emerged, however, the gunnery lieutenant had given order...
All guns, load!
This took only 15 seconds to accomplish. Therefore, when broadsides was effected and the last gun-ready lamp came on, it needed only one word to throw a quarter of a ton of steel and high explosive from one ship moving at 31 knots to another ship moving at 20 knots, 9 miles away.
Open fire! Up ladder, fire!
Later, the captain's report read...
Hits were observed.
Twelve shells were in the air at once, while the fountains raised by the six preceding ones still hung poised above the surface. Every 10 seconds, the guns were ready and loaded, and every 10 seconds, the shells were hurled out of them. Four hits with six broadsides was good shooting. And the Italian Navy was firing back straight at Artemis now. There were bright flashes all down the line, and sea and air were flung into convulsion.
Ah!
On the bridge, the sudden crash of the guns made Turningham jump. It always did. He hoped none of the men on duty up here had seen him jump. The second time, he was sure his feet had left the deck. The din was appalling, and with every broadside, he was shaken by the hot blast of the guns. The captain gave an order to the navigating lieutenant, and soon HMS Artemis heeled and turned abruptly away from the enemy and back into the comforting smoke and darkness and silence.
Captain, gunner there.
Gunnery officer.
We shall be opening fire again in 2 minutes.
And Artemis was already keeling over on the turn as she plunged back into the smoke screen to seek out her enemies once more.
1 minute.
Every man of the ship knew that the better he did his work now, the better would be his chance of life.
5 seconds. 2 minutes.
Guns ready. Open fire.
And the above torque roared its tons of steel again toward the eye tide. Artemis was shooting superbly. The captain could see that with his own eyes as he turned his binoculars upon the Italian flagship. The enemy salvos were creeping closer. It was nearly time to retire again. A mile away, another British ship, HMS Hera, had emerged from the smoke screen, spitting fire from all her turrets. With Hera out of the screen and the other cruisers beginning to show beyond her, it was for Artemis to withdraw and leave the Italians to their weary task of getting the range on these new elusive targets.
4-10!
And Artemis plunged back into the protecting smoke. Then, it happened. Fifty salvos had been fired at Artemis without scoring a hit. Now, when she was invisible in the smoky fog, a chance shell hit her. It was an 8-inch shell that hit the cruiser. It struck the ship's side a yard above the waterline, and it penetrated the main deck as it burst, flinging red-hot fragments of steel all around it. And with the fragments came the flame of explosion. The X-gun turret bore the brunt. The officer at the shell ring and the officer at the ammunition hoist killed by the jagged steel. 1 minute they were alive, and the next they were dead. 1 moment they were men, and then the shell burst right in their midst, and they were nothing. Nothing. The petty officer in charge of the lobby and the others survived them only by a few seconds. They died by fire, but it was a quick death.
Ship's on fire aft, sir.
Yes?
Pretty badly, apparently, sir.
Very good, Jernigan. Thank you.
One turret was out, but the A and B turrets were firing away beautifully, all four guns in white-hot action. At that moment... a shell was fired from HMS Artemis, which changed the face of the war, altered the whole history of the world. Men and women in Nigeria or Czechoslovakia would feel the impact of that shell upon their lives. Headhunting cannibals in Papua, Siberian nomads seeking a scant living on the frozen tundra of Asia, toddling babies in the cornfields of Iowa, and their children's children would all, in years to come, owe something to that shell. Of the four shells fired in that salvo, three of them missed. The fourth, the shell from the left-hand gun in turret A, hit. Later, the captain's report read...
the enemy turned away, and the action terminated.
That shell hadn't done any particular damage when it hit the Italian Majesty's battleship Lignano... but the dual Italian-German command of Sein Capitan Circe Helmuth von Bordica and Vice Admiral Gaspara Gaetano Nocentini were hesitating about what to do with a pesky little British ship. And they were arguing, politely, of course, on points of strategy. Also, they were suspicious of one another and, well, you know how it is with the Italians and the Germans. The main thing is that when that historical 6-inch shell struck full upon their B-turret and burst against the 12-inch steel, it became the deciding factor that tipped down the scale and swayed the balance of von Bordica's and Nocentini's hesitating minds.
The enemy turned away, and the action terminated.
The enemy's out of range, sir.
Thank you, guns.
I believe I saw a torpedo hit on the second ship while you were speaking, sir.
Thank you.
Congratulations, sir.
Thank you, Jerningham.
There was only the faintest glow to be seen of the fire that had raged minutes before. And a few more minutes with the hose would extinguish even that. The ship emerged into the fading dusk, for it was now beginning to grow dark. Then the captain suddenly tensed himself as his roving eye caught sight of a twinkle of light ahead. And then he was able to relax and even smile a little to himself in the twilight. For that was the evening star shining out over the Mediterranean.
All hands darken ship. Second degree of readiness.
Yes, the captain could now light his pipe. Could now, inwardly only perhaps, relax. He could now afford to indulge in the luxury of quiet thought.
This long struggle will someday have an end, I suppose, but not now, and not for months and years to come. And even when it does end, the freedom which the struggle will win can only be secured by eternal vigilance, eternal probity, eternal goodwill, and eternal honesty of purpose. That will be the hardest lesson of all. Peace will be a severer test of mankind than war. Perhaps mankind will pass that test when the time comes. As for me, when that time comes, I will fight to the last, die in the last ditch, before I will compromise in the slightest with the blind or secret enemies of freedom and justice.
You have heard the 7th program of Words at War, a series based on the great books of this war. This evening we presented The Ship by C.S. Forrester. The script was written by Edmund Bernbrier of the NBC script staff. Next week you'll hear Robert St. John's book, From the Land of Silent People. The narrator tonight was played by Alan Bunce. House Jameson was the captain. Other members of the cast were Victor Beecroft, Sid Cassell, Humphrey Davis, Ian McAllister, Shirley Oliver, and Alfred Shirley. The original music was written and conducted by Frank Black. The production was under the direction of Joseph Losey. This program has been presented in cooperation with the Council on Books in Wartime, for the National Broadcasting Company and the independent radio stations associated with the NBC network. This program came to you from New York. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
Words at War presents Robert St. John's From the Land of Silent People.
is the proud national anthem sung in Yugoslavia until the Nazis came. That is the scream of a Yugoslav woman. She's not being molested. Her pain is mental. She's just remembered something that happened on Bloody Sunday in Belgrade in Yugoslavia. That's the bomb that killed her husband. When she looked from a window of their house and saw him running across the square, disobeying the shouted orders of the soldiers and the police. The sight of a man being blown to pieces is a horrible thing to remember. The National Broadcasting Company, in cooperation with the Council on Books in Wartime, presents the sixth in the series, Words at War. Tonight, offering a radio adaptation of Robert St. John's great book, From the Land of Silent People. And now it is our pleasure to present in person Mr. Robert St. John.
Scriptwriter Neil Hopkins has prepared a dramatic impression of my book, which does not pretend to portray everything that I've written. Neither does it pretend to portray the hope which today surges through those occupied countries of Europe as Italy teeters and deliverance becomes more than a vague hope for the distant future. And since I don't pretend to be an actor, Don McLaughlin will play my part. From the Land of Silent People is my report on some nations and some people who are, for the moment, silent. I'm a reporter, and I saw it happen. Once on a lecture platform, the chairman of the meeting said to me...
Now, just one word of advice before you speak, Mr. St. John. Please remember that you're speaking after the dinner hour. Make your remarks pleasant. Don't make war seem too terrible. We don't want to disturb their digestions, you know.
I did not make pleasant remarks in that lecture. I told them, as we shall tell you tonight, something of what I saw and heard and smelled, and just a bit of what I thought during a few weeks of this war.
We are ready with your call to the Associated Press in Bern, Switzerland, Mr. St. John. There's Bern.
Associated Press, Bern waiting.
St. John's 11928, Belgrade, direct. Yugoslavia tonight has more than 1 million soldiers massed on her frontiers in preparation for war, following a day of... Hello. Hello, hello, Associated Press. Hello, operator.
Pardon, monsieur. You have been interrupted. Yes,
sir. Bad reading.
St. John's 11928, Belgrade, direct.
You have been interrupted, monsieur.
I know that, but why? Who's interrupting me?
Undoubtedly the censors, Mr. St. John.
Censors? But this dispatch has been cleared by the censors, operator. I got a rubber stamp on every page.
Yes, Bern, monsieur.
Hey, Bern, skip the first paragraph. I don't think they like it. Let's start with the second. You ready?
Ready.
For 12 hours today, a frenzied crowd... Hopeless. Hopeless these last days of March and the first days of April 1941. Hopeless trying to get a dispatch out of Belgrade. Simovich, the commander of the Air Force, has taken over. He's thrown out the government that sold Yugoslavia to Hitler and Mussolini. Simovich is playing a dangerous game, and he knows it. But he'll fight. Fight against a necklace of steel around Yugoslavia's neck. Italian troops on the northwest, Italian troops in Albania, Nazi troops, Nazi planes, Nazi tanks lined up along the Romanian, Bulgarian, and Hungarian frontiers. In Belgrade, the people cheer and sing the Yugoslavian national anthem. The will to fight Nazi tyranny is alive and singing in Yugoslavia, this April of 1941. The means to fight have not been found wanting. Not yet. In Belgrade, Simovich reforms the government, stalls for time, orders the German legation to leave Yugoslavia.
Well, St. John, nice of you to see us off.
Tell me, do any of Herr Hitler's representatives remain in Belgrade?
By tomorrow morning, there won't be a single German left in Yugoslavia, except our military attaché and his assistant, and their two servants. They'll be ready for anything.
What is anything likely to mean?
No matter. Cheer up, St. John. We'll be back soon, we Germans. Probably very soon. And when we do come, we'll bring a few souvenirs. Bye, St. John. Take care.
Take care. Spoken like a warning. Or perhaps a command.
Don't move!
Don't move. A command, the way Sonia says it. Schmidt-Pop, the Hungarian press representative, introduced me to Sonia a few minutes ago in the hotel dining room. Then came a telephone call for Schmidt-Pop. And now we're alone.
Don't move, because I'm terrified. Please hold my hand tighter. I hate all this. It frightens me so. Blackness. Those horrible sirens, I...
Sonia is a well-traveled university graduate. She holds an important government position. She knows just about everything. Right now, she knows fear in a Belgrade blackout, while a gypsy violin drowns out
those
the sound.
Those horrible sirens, I...
There's nothing to fear, baby. It's just a rehearsal.
Yes, but the real show will come soon. Yugoslavia will fight. With empty hands, she will fight the giant. Then, what will we do? We are not soldiers.
Well, I know what I'm going to do. I'm getting myself a car and following Simovic into the hills of South Serbia. For with the government, we ought to be fairly safe. We ought to have some communications.
Oh, take me with you.
Oh, not on your life.
Oh, please take me with you. I can't stay here. You mustn't leave me behind. I'll die of fright if I don't get killed by the bombs. Listen, Mr. St. John, you hardly know me, but I'll be good. I speak the language. I can help you. And I won't make any trouble. Just let me go alone.
You'll have to expect to be treated like a man. It'll be tough going.
Look, the lights. The lights come on again.
Did you hear me, Sonia?
Yes, I know. I won't mind. And listen, I promise to bring along 3 quarts of good Scotch whiskey in 4 bottles of French champagne. Okay? Oh, please.
It's a deal.
Fine. And now, will you please take me home? Will you? So you will know exactly how to find me.
Sure.
We can walk past the park. There are spring flowers now. And the good, clean, fresh air. So nice.
Yeah, for how long? Next week, that clean, fresh air may smell of gunpowder and burning buildings and burning people.
No. No. It must not be. But whatever comes, you have promised me on your honor to take me with you when you leave Belgrade. You must write down my telephone number also. Now.
All right. And speaking of telephones, I must take you home and get back to my rooms upstairs. I'm expecting a call from Switzerland, perhaps from the United States.
America? In war? You can talk to America? How wonderful. How perfect. Wonderful.
St. John speaking.
Berlin calling.
Berlin?
Associated Press, Berlin.
AP, Berlin?
Oui, monsieur, that is correct.
Oui, monsieur, that is correct. Oh, so, so, so correct. What are you doing tonight, St. John?
I was just thinking of bed. So what? You got a little party on up there?
Seriously, St. John, if I were you, I wouldn't go to bed tonight. So long.
Hey, wait a minute. Why shouldn't I go to bed?
Oh, I don't have any idea. But we think up here it would be an excellent night for you to sit up, listening to the music from the Berlin Broadcasting Station. Good night. Good luck, St. John.
This is the resurrection and the death. This is Palm Sunday, April 6, 1941. This is Belgrade in Yugoslavia. This is not murder. This is slaughter. I don't remember exactly how many of the American correspondents and radio men are in and around the hotel this Sunday morning. There's several of us coming and going on one mission or another. I remember Lee White. I remember Russell Hill of the New York Herald Tribune. I remember Ray Brock of the New York Times. That's Brock standing with me on the hotel balcony. Yes, there they are. 40 Nazi bombers, 2 miles up and coming over fast. We must go to the hotel lobby now and stand there like sheep staring at each other's faces.
stand there like sheep waiting for the slaughter. There's no dugout in the cellar. Belgrade was going to be declared an undefended city if war ever came. But the bombers are here. Nobody's had time to make any declarations. Ray Brock and I go downstairs. The symphony begins. The symphony of slaughter. This is the first and only movement. Full and terrible without a single solo instrument. Bombers moving forward. Bombers diving. Bombs falling. Bombs bursting. Anti-aircraft guns. Pom-pom guns. Machine guns. Buildings cracking. Buildings falling. Somewhere under it all must be the screams of defenseless dead and dying men and women and children. But these are the little voices in the symphony of slaughter. Not warriors, but lovers of peace. Little people. Let me speak for them. Let me shout above it all for this one moment. Let me proclaim. This is the resurrection and the death. This is Palm Sunday, the death of a city, the birth of a silent people. This is April the 6th, 1941. This is Belgrade in Yugoslavia. This is the symphony of slaughter. This is Bloody Sunday. Church bell? Oh, yes, yes, of course. Church bells are on God's side. Once General Smuts in South Africa said to Frank Gervasi of Collier's magazine, "We'll win, my boy, because God's on our side." Gervasi said, "Excuse me, General, I don't mean to be sacrilegious, but how many planes does God have? How many planes does Yugoslavia have?" The American legation, we found Lee White, the radio commentator. The legation, we found some of the other press correspondents. We made plans. The day before we started for Sarajevo, on our way to escape by the sea, Russell Hill and I talked to a Yugoslav soldier. He could speak a little English. I think he was a dispatch rider.
We're not telling you you can't win. We're just telling you what you'll have to face when the Nazi military machine starts to move in. We've seen it in action. Isn't that so, St. John?
Yeah, of course it is.
We Yugoslavs are fighting men. We will continue fighting to the end for freedom.
Will you come up against tanks?
Tanks? What are tanks?
Is he kidding us?
You speak English. You know what tanks are.
What are tanks?
Listen. Tanks are steel fortresses rolling on tracks they lay down themselves. Inside are men and guns. Big guns. Those are the things you're going
to
fight.
Yeah, and your job is going to be to stop them. But how are you going to do it?
Well, why do I have this?
Your rifle? Rifle bullets won't even make a dent in a tank.
Are you sure there are men in those tanks?
Take our word for it, soldier. There are men inside the tanks.
Then it is easy. If there are men inside, they have got to come out sometime, no? You nod your heads yes, huh?
We nod our heads yes. Now what?
Well, then, we wait until the men come out of the tank. And when they come out, we shoot them.
It was as simple as that. I think Russell Hill and I both must have shuddered. This is the kind of an army Simovich is planning to throw against the Nazis. Lord help Yugoslavia. Tomahawks against rifles. Rifles against machine guns. Machine guns against planes. This is worse than any of them. Rifles against tanks. Worse, but not the worst. There was the Oxcart army we passed on the road to Uzica in Sarajevo. Not an emergency measure, not at all. Oxen, 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 teams of oxen pulling carts. Carts loaded with military supplies and provisions and soldiers. We counted. It was tiresome, but we had nothing else to do. We counted 1,500 ox carts. We counted 3,000 head of oxen pulling the ox carts. This is time marching backward to fight a Nazi military machine marching forward. Sonia's with us from Sarajevo to the sea. Sonia pushing her way across the floor of the crowded cafe.
I have found you. There you are.
She doesn't complain about hunting around Belgrade for 2 days for the American newspaper man who promised to help her and didn't. She doesn't say much about bombs and machine guns and death. I don't want to talk to her about Belgrade and dead bodies. I want to talk about tall, cool bottles and other things that aren't important. We've been drinking Slivovich prune whiskey because we don't have enough food. My head's swimming. All I can remember to say is, How much of champagne and the scotch?
How did you expect me to bring champagne and scotch when you deserted me? And I didn't have a car.
Cheer up. I won't desert you this time.
Let's go shopping.
Let's go shopping. That's Sonia, trying to pretend that we aren't all sitting right on the edge of the pit. A certain shade of face powder, a certain special brand. I keep thinking, when you get hit in the face with a bomb fragment, lady, it doesn't matter which shade of powder you happen to... Oh, that's cruel. And this is Sonia in action.
Mr. District Chief, these Americans are my friends. So I have suffered much in a country which is our country, not theirs. Still, they do not flee from us. They try to help us. We need 50 liters of gasoline. Yes, I know all that kind of people have come to you. I know your weariness of these appeals. Nevertheless, I beg 50 liters of gasoline. Please.
I will allow you 60 liters.
We do not have food. We need food. Me and my American friends out there.
This is only what remains of the cafe. We have no food. There is Slivovich and tea.
Oh, we are sick, Miss Spoon Whiskey and tea. We are sick, and we have far to go. You have a little can of cherries? I sauce a little can of cherries.
They are not worth anything. I cannot cheat you. Your American friends will tell you they are worth 10 cents.
But a can of cherries is food.
And so I must keep them.
Would you like this leather jacket I'm wearing? You are small. My jacket would fit you.
For a 10-cent can of cherries?
Take the jacket. My friends cannot eat my leather jacket.
Little things like that. Sonia in action from Sarajevo to the sea. And then at Budva on the coast of the Adriatic, Russell Hill and I have a talk.
Bob.
You awake? You still awake, Russ? What do you want now?
At Budva's, the Makedanka.
Yeah, what about the Makedanka?
Well, she's just a 20-foot sardine boat. She's just got a 1-cylinder outboard engine, a sail, and 4 oars in case.
I know all of that. What of it?
Well, now we've got Terry Atherton of the London Daily Mail with us. And besides you and me, there's Kay of United Press, Lee White.
So?
You in love with Sonia, Bob?
Don't talk nonsense. Of course not.
Well, the Makedanka is nothing more than a rowboat, Bob. Now, to make a getaway, we've got to go hundreds of miles down the Adriatic, down the coast of Yugoslavia, Albania, until we hit the Greek mainland somewhere, or the Greek island of Corfu. Now, part of that time, we'll be snug between the heel of Italy and Albania. We've got no food.
A long sea voyage in an overgrown rowboat. No food. If we do get picked up by the Italian Navy, it'll be a lot tougher for her than us.
Well?
Hey, you're right. Sonia can't go with us. I left Yugoslavia that night with a lot of pictures indelibly stamped in my mind. Pictures of dead bodies in the square in Belgrade, mangled bodies in Sarajevo when the bombs came there. Crowds of bewildered people in Budva waiting for the bombs to come. But one of the clearest pictures was the picture of Sonia. Sonia standing in the middle of a road in the foothills of the Dalmatian Mountains, waving a red handkerchief. Sonia's saying,
"Goodbye, Mr. St. John. I know you wanted to help me. Goodbye, baby. It's real American talk, is it not, baby? Good luck."
There is some suffering on a boat. That covers it quickly and simply. The name of the boat's the Makedanka. It's a name I shall never forget. She's 20 feet long. And 5 men who know little or nothing about sailing are sailing this boat southeastward through a sea they know nothing about. We sail by the stars, and we're too ignorant of simple astronomy to know that the stars swing about the heavens as the earth turns. We have a little stale bread. We have a few cans of this and that. We have some raisins. We have 40 pounds of smoked ham. Understand, this is raw ham, not cooked, just smoked. We run through storms. We run through minefields. We quarreled bitterly among ourselves. Five reporters unable to report. Five hungry, angry men. And now...
Hey, look! Islands dead ahead! Islands! Must be those islands just off Corfu.
We grab our maps. After a while, Russell Hill, who's a very precise map reader, says...
Yeah, that's right, boys. Those are the three little islands, and there's Corfu just beyond.
Hey, wonderful!
Well, hotels and beds and clean sheets and cable offices and a place to sit down and write a story. Now, in heaven's name, St. John, dish out some food for us, will you?
Food! I'll give you a feast! Listen to that! That's a loaf of good Serbian bread we've been using to hammer the oarlocks back in place. And see this little can?
Yeah.
In this little can is a feast. This is pheasant paste.
What? No.
From the bird of the same name. Pheasant paste on peasant bread. And the Waldorf Astoria touch. In honor of peace and quiet, two slices of our only orange to every man.
I've been holding on.
Oh, very, very swank.
And why not? We made it. There's Greek land just ahead. There's order and discipline and common sense and cables. We can get our stories off to New York now. We can be reporters again. We can tell them the story of Bloody Sunday in Belgrade. We've made it. We can tell them.
No need to wave your American flag. You can put your hands down now. I can see what you are. But get out of the boat.
You speak excellent English.
Maybe. I went to school in Chicago. Who are you?
I'm Robert St. John, Associated Press. These men...
Never mind. It can wait. There is some danger here on this beach.
But you don't understand. We're American and English radio newspaper people.
Your credentials will be examined later, Mr. St. John.
But this is Greece, a friendly country.
For you? Probably. Your credentials will be examined later. Out of the boat now. All of you.
Listen, we've come hundreds of miles down through minefields and Italian ships and storms to get to Greece, a friendly country. Now we're being greeted with rifles. We're reporters. We fought our way through to tell the story of Yugoslavia. Yugoslavia bombed into silence. 2 weeks
it's
ago...
It's just the same here, Mr. St. John. Out of the boat. All of you.
Yes, quite the same. The same symphony of slaughter. Bombers moving forward. Bombers diving. Bombs. Nazi machine gun. Very special job. We're on the Greek mainland, somehow on a troop train, Patras to Corinth. Nazi machine guns, a very special job. Train running along the very edge of the Gulf of Corinth. Very, very, very straight drop down there. Wonderful spot for a plane to poke his machine guns into a train window. Wonderful spot. Wonderful slaughter. It's a strange thing. You couldn't hear the screams of the dead and dying men because of the screams of the dead and dying men. You couldn't hear the sound of the plane because of the sound of the plane. The sound of the machine gun because of the sound of the machine gun. It starts quietly, the symphony of slaughter. Lee White was badly hit. I got just a sprinkling of steel in my leg. British Army trucks helped us to get Lee to an X-ray man's house in Argos. Argos, just a little Greek town. Atherton and I are together when the planes come over again. Some panicky people said that they had taken Lee White to the X-ray man's clinic. We found the clinic, all right, but I wish we never had. Because out in front on the sidewalk lay what once had been a man. Look at him. Both his hands are blown off at the wrist. One leg's in shreds. His shrapnel's ripped open his stomach. Yet he screams. Like he screams words. Atherton, I've got to find out what he wants. You. You speak English?
I speak. Yes.
What's he saying? Tell me.
He got no hands, you see.
I can see that. What does he say?
He say, I want my money. He wants somebody to get money out of his pocket. At a blood store for pills. He say he got very bad pain in head.
Atherton. We're dead, Atherton. You hear me? We're dead. We're in hell. This isn't Greece. This is hell.
Ladies and gentlemen, may we reintroduce in person the distinguished author of the book, From the Land of Silent People, Mr. Robert St. John.
I called them silent people because as I fled from Europe, I knew that the vast majority of those people would be silent for a few years as they suffered and starved under Nazi domination, waiting for the light. But not completely silent. Bands of guerrillas in both Yugoslavia and in Greece for more than 2 years now have been harassing the enemy. And tonight I can imagine the new hope which surges through the breasts of those occupied millions. I know how they get their news over there, over hidden clandestine radio receivers, by whispered word of mouth. The news that the Tommies and the Doughboys have cleaned the Axis out of Africa, that the Tommies and the Doughboys have landed in Sicily, that Rome has been bombed, that the Russians are closing in on Orel, that 1,000 planes have raised Essen, Germany, that Mussolini, who ordered that barbarous attack on Greece, has been yanked from his balcony. They know that every one of those events brings the armies of the United Nations that much closer to their frontiers, brings victory and deliverance that much closer to realization. Yes, hope does surge up in the weary breasts of those silent people who someday soon will be silent no more.
As the sixth program of Words at War, we have presented a radio interpretation of the book From the Land of Silent People by Robert St. John. It was adapted for radio by Neil Hopkins, one of the NBC script staff. Mr. St. John was played by Don McLaughlin. Other members of the cast included Elisel Falke, Joseph DeSantis, Richard Keith, Sam Wanamaker, Peter Capel, Lottie Stavisky, John Griggs, and Gilbert Mack. The original music was composed by Morris Mimorski and conducted by Joseph Stopak. The production was under the direction of Joseph Losey. Words at War presents episodes from Prisoner of the Japs by Gwen Ju, a vivid eyewitness account of a survivor of the fall of Hong Kong. Words at War is brought to you in cooperation with the Council on Books in Wartime by the National Broadcasting Company and the independent radio stations associated with the NBC network.
Words at War, presenting Gwen Dew's Prisoner of the Japs.
Hong Kong? What is Hong Kong, anyway?
Hong Kong? Why, it's a tiny island off the coast of China.
Oh, Chinese?
Well, no, it's a British colony. It's one of the most powerful outposts of the empire.
Sorry to interrupt. Perhaps you have not heard of Japan's Greater East Asia co-prosperity sphere.
Oh, we don't need to worry about that. Hong Kong's an impenetrable fortress. Has been for 100 years.
But this is 1941.
Hong Kong Airport has been destroyed. All planes smashed. All naval installations are under artillery bombardment. Japan is at war with Hong Kong.
Words at War. Tonight, the National Broadcasting Company, in cooperation with the Council on Books in Wartime, brings you another in its series of radio adaptations of important books of this war. Each week, selected episodes are dramatized from some of the most stirring of our war-inspired literature. Tonight, we hear the story of an American newspaper woman who happened to be in Hong Kong on the day the Japanese attacked. The book is Prisoner of the Japs. The author is Gwen Du.
Monday, December 8th, 1941, was to have been my last day in Hong Kong. I'd planned to take a plane that evening from the airport the Japanese smashed. I didn't want to leave Hong Kong. Something was going to happen there, and that's why I'd come in the first place, as correspondent for the Detroit News and Newsweek magazine. But that Monday, I was going to leave. No one left. Only those who died. The defenders of Hong Kong were pushed steadily back. The city was squeezed like a nut in the jaws of a nutcracker until the shell of it and the meat of it were mashed. It took the Japs 17 days to capture the Gibraltar of the East. I lived in a hotel, the Repulse Bay Hotel. I was there along with 200 other British and Americans and a small garrison of soldiers. You take time for a cup of tea, soldier? I can't see you, so I don't know who you are.
Just a second, miss, after I get this one. Maybe I got that one. Name's Arden, miss. I know you. I recognize your voice.
I hope you got him.
What difference would one more make? I ask you, what difference? You kill them, and they keep on coming.
Please have some tea, Arden. Just a sip. Give me your hand. It's so dark in here, you might spill it. Careful. You got the cup?
Got it. Thanks, miss. That tastes good. You women have been swell. Cleaning and scrubbing up the messes, feeding us.
You sound so tired.
I feel as if I was 90 years old.
How old are you?
23. I used to wonder how I'd feel if I killed a man. I've been in the volunteer corps here a couple of years. But I've always been frightened that, well, that I'd be scared to kill someone.
Now?
Now. If I could personally kill every Japanese on this island, I'd be happy.
Day after day, night after night. At night, you couldn't sleep. There was only gunfire and terror. I used to almost pray for the light to come, even though it meant more horrible things would happen. In the morning, at least, you could lift the blackout curtains and look across the bay to the mainland, now held by the Japanese. On the fifth morning of the siege, in the early morning light, I saw... I could hardly believe it. A boat detach itself from the others and start for our side of the shore, toward Hong Kong. Machine guns began to bark. I thought some crazy fool was trying to escape from the Japs. I looked through the telephoto lens on my camera. In the bow of the boat, I could see a sign on a large white banner. It said, Peace Mission.
Like everything else today, Miss Du.
Three Japanese officers coming into the heart of Hong Kong?
Look at them. Strutting up the steps
as
if they...
I could get a picture?
I am Colonel Tada of Military Information.
I am Major Boxer of His Majesty's...
Young lady.
Yes?
That camera. You are a photographer.
I'm a reporter for an American newspaper.
You want to take photographs?
I'd like to.
Oh, certainly. Come over here, please. I will stand here. Captain Osu on my right. Arsenal on my left. Shall we all smile? Young lady, take your photograph. There. Remember, please. I am Colonel Isumo Tada of Japanese Military Intelligence. Someday you will write about me when the war is over.
Yes, Colonel Tada.
Oh, so. Now, Major Boxer, we have come with an offer of peace from the Japanese government.
I shall send word at once to the Governor General.
Perhaps you should add that not only is Hong Kong doomed, but also that Pearl Harbor has been destroyed. The American Navy has been sunk. Yes?
I shall send word to the Governor General immediately. The The answer, Colonel Tata, is no surrender.
No surrender? Indeed.
No surrender.
You shall have until 4 o'clock this afternoon to change your minds. The war shall be resumed if we do not hear from your government. This is all, then, I think. Come, Asano. Also, Major Boxer, you will order your men to withhold fire till 4 o'clock. Then, if we have heard no more from you, the war will go on. Good afternoon.
Yo, forget. My name is Dick. Dick.
I say, Major Stewart, if the war's got to go on, those chaps are in our hands. You could, you know, you could.
Fire on them. Not until 4 o'clock, Mr. Holmes.
That afternoon, war began again and continued. Through the fifth night, through the sixth day, the seventh, the eighth, the ninth. And after each of those days, another night of terror, weariness, despair. The ammunition getting low.
Miss Dew.
Water going. Food.
Miss Dew.
Yes, here I am.
Arden, miss. Will you do me a favor?
Of course.
It's the dark. Give me a hand. There. Got it? A piece of paper.
Yes.
My mother's address is on it. Will you try to get a message to her sometime?
Sure. Arden, it looks bad, but you mustn't
Listen,
think...
Listen, Miss Dew, we're getting out. The soldiers, I mean, tonight. We're going to try to crawl to Fort Stanley. There'll only be civilians in the hotel in the morning.
Only civilians?
Yes. Then maybe the Japs won't kill everyone.
That meant we were surrendering. The British flag was coming down. The white flag of surrender was going up. We must bow to the blood-stained banner of the rising sun. The corridors of the hotel were filled with people trying to sleep. I didn't think I could. But I went to the crowded room I shared with a number of other people. Somehow I must have dozed off. It was morning, again, and the unbelievable thing was true. The Japs were in possession of the hotel. I'll never forget those guards. For the rest of my life, whenever I see teeth too big for a face, or a bayonet too long for a gun, I'll think of those Japanese guards. One of our Jap guards had discovered the piano in the dining room and was banging away at it, while we, men, women, and children, were marched off to captivity. Prisoners. Of the Japs. Overhead, as we walked, Japanese planes were playfully dropping bombs. And underfoot...
Look out, Miss Dew. Careful where you're walking.
Oh. Oh. It's one of our men.
Yes, miss.
Arden.
Can't be sure, Miss Dew.
He didn't get through to Fort Stanley. These men.
The Japs don't bury their enemies, miss. Didn't you know? They consider it a particularly delicate form of insult to let them lie there day after day in the sun under the flies.
When we reached the city, the guards finally let us sit down in the gutter and rest. After carrying 45 pounds of camera equipment all day, I was pretty glad of a rest. Towards evening, we ended up in a deserted paint factory. No furniture, no plumbing, just three empty floors and one candle to each floor. We were packed in like pigs in a stockyard so close we could hardly sit down. 200 frightened, homeless people. And like people everywhere, we took out our feelings in different ways. Some in weeping.
I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills from whence
Some in
cometh
prayer.
My help. My help cometh from the Lord.
I would be much advised if you take your elbow out of my...
And a few took it out in quarreling.
Hand me your line. Where shall I put it, your
honor?
Why do you have to hold that box in your arms if you put it down?
In this crowd, everything I got is in this box.
And who's going to steal your trash? We've got
trash. Oh, fire me hands free. I'll show you who was trash.
You two have to quarrel. Aren't things bad enough already?
Yes, for goodness sakes, you shut up. Think of the children. After all, this is Christmas Eve. Now, look here, people. I know we all feel awful, but we've got to keep our chins up. Let's try to think about something else. It's Christmas. Can somebody sing a carol, perhaps?
Oh, Christmas carol.
Oh, I mean it. Now, let's try. Come along, somebody. Who knows the old little town of Bethlehem?
They were trying hard. As for me, well, I'm a newspaper woman, and I was busy keeping my eyes open. That was my job. Most of the people in the room I knew, but the Japs had thrown in a few strangers with us. One of these was a nurse sitting right beside me.
Here's a song everybody knows.
You're a Red Cross nurse, aren't you?
Yes.
Did you see much of the fighting?
Yes.
Where were you?
At St. Stephen's Hospital.
Oh.
It was the day before yesterday, early in the morning. Hundreds of wounded British and Canadian soldiers, some of them even lying on the floor. And then the Japs came. They killed Dr. Whitney. Dr. Black, too. The Japs tore the bandages off the wounded men, ran their bayonets through them for practice. For fun. Then they took us, the nurses, away, one by one. We were there all day, all night. You are a reporter, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
Then tell them what happened to me, to the rest of the nurses. Tell them in America, so they'll know what our enemies are like.
Nothing to sleep on. Nothing but rice and water to eat. Life goes on. Then at last, the entire foreign colony, 3,500 British, Dutch, and Americans, were all herded together and moved to an old dirty hotel, the Kowloon, and other Chinese brothels.
You are now prisoners of Japan. Any infringement of orders will be punished by death, according to military law.
We were locked up 8 or 10 to a room, men and women together. One day I was alone, trying to sleep. Suddenly I became conscious that someone was standing beside me. People who knew the Japanese had warned me never to show any fear, no matter what happened. So I just lay there on the floor and pretended to be asleep. And then I felt something cold, smooth, and sharp on my throat. I knew it was a bayonet. Moving slowly across my throat, under my chin, from one ear to the other. I could feel a point resting for a moment under my left ear, under the jugular vein. Then it slid back again across my throat. Cold, smooth, sharp. I didn't breathe. It was a long, long time. Finally, I heard a sigh. Then the toe of a boot gave me a kick. I opened my eyes, and one of the guards was standing over me, grinning at his little joke.
Missy afraid?
No. No, I wasn't afraid.
Missy rave. Missy, get up. Have note for me, see? From Colonel Tada.
To the American young lady cameraman, I would like you to come to tea. I am very busy, but will arrange in a few days for you to come to the Peninsula Hotel. Colonel Tada.
An invitation to tea with the jailer. Well, why shouldn't I go? I was hungry. Besides, I was a reporter. The day came. I was so weak I could hardly walk to the colonel's hotel, but finally I made it. And I was taken to his suite. A room with chairs to sit in. And food.
Will you have another sandwich, Miss Du?
I've had 11 already.
Then have a piece of pastry.
I'll have another sandwich first, now I'll have a piece of pastry.
Well, certainly.
Thank you.
Now, tell me, Miss Du, you are probably wondering why I invited you here today. Are you not?
Well, yes, I was, Colonel Tata.
It is very simple. I admire courage. I was very much impressed that day when you took our photographs. You did not show fear. So, I thought sometime I will see this American newspaper woman. We will talk together.
So you're giving me an interview, Colonel Tata?
I can afford to. You are my prisoner.
All right, then. If this is an interview, here's a question. What does Japan hope to gain by this war? Even if she won, most of her navy would be gone, her buildings destroyed.
Even so. In the meantime, Japan will have taken all the resources of 1,000,000 miles of land, Malaya and its rubber, which your country needs so badly. Its chrome, the oil from East India, and so on and so on.
What about your men? 1,000,000 of your men will be dead.
Miss Yu, you Americans lose sight of our physiology and psychology. We would rather die for Japan than live for her. From the battlefield, white boxes of ashes are sent home for the family shrines. Don't forget, Miss Du, we Japanese do not think of this war in the terms of this year or next. We think of the future history of Japan. You know how one white race after another, the Greeks, the Romans, the French, have risen and then declined. The past belonged to these white races. But the future belongs to us. Soon the whole world will be speaking Japanese.
You talk as if the war were already won, Colonel Tata.
Oh, Japan is already the second largest empire in the world. And the American fleet was practically destroyed at Pearl Harbor.
Pearl Harbor? Colonel Tata, I'm afraid Americans will never forgive you for striking while your ambassadors were still in the White House talking peace.
Oh, yes, I know. But there is the way it had to be done. You can win a war in only one way. Destroy the enemy before he destroys you. Miss Du, we leave Europe to Germany. For the rest of the world, we are the new masters. And now, Miss Du, you must leave me. Oh, as a token of my kindness, I ask you to accept this jar of jam.
P.S. I took the jam.
I told you, Miss Dew, you ought to leave. I told you. And you just kept saying there's going to be a war and you wanted to see the balloon go up.
And it did, didn't it, Sergeant? The balloon went up all right. I just didn't think the blooming thing would come down.
Now, Miss Doe. Tears from such as you. I am surprised, Miss Doe. Now, we'll be all right.
From the hotel, we were taken to a large internment camp. It was crowded and filthy, and we still had the same starvation diet. We set up a sort of primitive housekeeping. Everyone had duties, cooking, washing, sanitation. By now, we'd been prisoners 6 months. There was one thing that kept us from despair. We'd heard rumors that there was to be an exchange of prisoners, so many Americans for so many Japs. No one knew who the lucky ones were to be, but we all made plans. And in the meeting hall, someone had drawn a map of the Pacific on the wall with our probable route home. We were weak, we were ill and homesick. But we tried to keep up our spirits. In the British group, there was an amusing character, Brigadier General Maurice Abraham Cohen, bodyguard to Dr. Sun Yat-sen. General Cohen was a blockade runner, guerrilla fighter, and now a prisoner. It was the general's birthday, so I suggested a party.
A speech!
Yeah, a speech!
Ladies and gentlemen, I accept this party as a tribute to my charm and good looks. And I must admit, it's only my due. What with this rice and water diet, my figure now has the graceful curves
of a picket fence.
Right. But as we're paying tribute, there's the Reverend Dill Orman, for instance. Him and his sanitation squad have kept this filthy hole something like human. And of all the nasty jobs, I guess theirs takes the cake.
Cake, did you say? What, that cake?
That's right, General. Keep food out of this. You don't want to start a riot.
My mistake. And then there's our dearest enemy, the kitchen squad, who, in spite of the hate we bear them, keep right on trying to find new ways to cook rice. Yeah, three cheers for the kitchen squad. Hip, hip.
Thanks.
And last but not least is our indispensable friend, Mr. Arlington. It's safe to say that if Mr. Arlington didn't spend his days picking the livestock out of the rice, we'd all be dead of starvation by this time. So, ladies and gentlemen, I give you Mr. Arlington.
Wait a minute. I've been waiting to bring out my surprise. I've had it hidden away for some special occasion. Look.
A jar of something.
A jar of jam.
Blackberry jam.
You mean it's all new jar of jam? Unopened?
Unopened. We're going to open it now. See? Didn't I tell you it was a real party?
Blackberry jam. Oh, Gwen. I know it's silly of me, but I think I'm going to cry.
The door.
Good evening. I say... good evening.
Good evening.
Oh, a party. A jam. Blackberry jam. Very nice. But not good for weak stomach. So...
don't touch that jam.
You are my prisoners. I take care of you. Jam bad for you. So, excuse, please. I take to window. I throw out window.
Oh.
Now, you not be sick. Now, I have news. Our government make exchange prisoners. American and Japanese.
Who?
Diplomats and writers. Later, you hear more. That is all. Now, I go.
It is... is drawing on wall?
That? That's just a map. Of the Pacific.
We heard there was a chance of our going home. We were just figuring on the route.
Where is Japan on your map?
Well, you see, we didn't think we'd stop at Japan, so we didn't bother putting it on.
Did not bother. Oh. Give me pencil. Here, I show you Japan, China, India, Australia, Hawaii, West Coast America, Alaska, Eastern Russia. All that is Japan. Remember that when you go home. Mark it on your maps. And if you are asked, if you are ever slapped on face, then say yes, and yes, and yes.
Well, we could bear anything now. We were going home. And at last the exchange was made and the rescue ship set out. The Osamu Maru from Yokohama to meet the Gripsholm from New York. After 7 months of starvation and torture, we were actually sailing the route we had traced so often on our map. Hong Kong, Saigon, past Singapore, through the Indian Ocean, down the East African coast, and into Lorenzo Marquez. And as we drew into the harbor, we saw the Gripsholm waiting for us, the brave white crosses of protection standing out proudly on her decks. And coming out to meet us was a convoy of 12 boats, battered old hulks of tankers, freighters, tugs, a rusty, bedraggled crew. But flying from their masts, the most beautiful sight on earth, the Union Jack and the Stars and Stripes. And as they drew nearer, they joined in a chorus of welcome, a sound that lifted our hearts, the promise of victory and peace and freedom.
We present in person the author of Prisoner of the Japs, Gwen Dew.
Some of us came home, but 150,000 Allied soldiers and civilians are still prisoners of the Japs. Tonight we have tried to tell you what that means. We have forced ourselves to speak of those days so that you may understand Japan. She has taken 1 million square miles of territory, and we have won back 200 square miles. Perhaps if you can remember what we have said tonight, it will help us to crushed Japan's new empire before the friends we had to leave have died. Prisoners of the Japs.
You have heard the seventh program of Words at War, a series based on the leading war books. This evening, we presented Prisoners of the Japs by Gwen Dew. The adaptation was by Nora Sterling of the NBC script staff. Next week, you'll hear a dramatization of Love at First Flight, the hilarious book by Charles Spaulding and Otis Carney. The part of Gwen Dew was played by Joan Alexander. Colonel Tada was played by Ted Osborne. Other members of the cast were Leslie Woods, Maurice Tarplin, Flora Campbell, John O'Connor, Milton Herman, Guy Rep, and Sidney Castles. The original music was written by Morris Momorsky and conducted by Joseph Stopak. The production was under the direction of Joseph Losey. This program has been presented in cooperation with the Council on Books in Wartime by the National Broadcasting Company and the independent radio stations associated with the NBC network. This program came to you from New York.
Ray Brock and I go downstairs. The symphony begins. The symphony of slaughter. This is the first and only movement, full and terrible, without a single solo instrument. Bombers moving forward, bombers diving, bombs falling, bombs bursting, anti-aircraft guns, pom-pom guns, machine guns, buildings cracking, buildings falling. Somewhere under it all must be the screams of defenseless dead and dying men and women and children. But these are the little voices in the symphony of slaughter, not warriors, but lovers of peace, little people. Let me speak for them. Let me shout above it all for this one moment. Let me proclaim, this is the resurrection and the death. This is Palm Sunday, the death of a city, the birth of a silent people. This is April the 6th, 1941. This is Belgrade in Yugoslavia. This is a symphony of slaughter. This is Bloody Sunday. Church bell? Oh, yes, yes, of course. Church bells are on God's side. Once General Smuts in South Africa said to Frank Gervasi of Collier's magazine, "We'll win, my boy, because God's on our side." Gervasi said, "Excuse me, General."
Taker began its chant.
Range 210, range 205, range 200.
In exactly 4 minutes, the enemy shot up suddenly over the curve of the world, climbing over it with astonishing speed.
Port 15, revolutions for 27 knots.
Port 15,
revolutions for 27 knots.
Visibility was at its best. The enemy ships made hard, sharp silhouettes against the blue and gray background. Paymaster Sub-Lieutenant James Jerningham knew himself to be a coward. But some time ago, he made up his mind to be a coward lacking in nothing. He spent hours in his cabin, carefully studying the pictured profiles of hostile ships. Study carried out in a mood of desperation, of despair. And he had a photographic memory which enabled him to recall the very pages on which he had seen those profiles, even the very print beneath them.
The two leading ships are heavy cruisers, Bolzano, sir. 9,000 tons, 8 8-inch guns, 32 knots.
You're sure? Aren't they?
No, sir. And the last three cruisers look like Bandoneri's. I don't know about the first one, though, sir. She's like nothing we've been told about. I suppose she's the new one, Cadorna, and the intelligence people didn't get her profile right.
I expect you're right.
I think I am, sir.
Out of 500 who started as naval cadets,
Which reforms the government, stalls for time, orders the German legation to leave Yugoslavia.
Wilson, John, nice of you to see us off.
Tell me, do any of Herr Hitler's representatives remain in Belgrade?
By tomorrow morning, there won't be a single German left in Yugoslavia, except our military attaché and his assistant, and their two servants. They'll be ready for anything.
What is anything likely to mean?
No matter. Cheer up, St. John. We'll be back soon, we Germans. Probably very soon. And when we do come, we'll bring a few souvenirs. Bye, St. John. Take care.
Take care. Spoken like a warning. Or perhaps a command.
Don't move!
Don't move. A command, the way Sonia says it. Schmidt-Pop, the Hungarian press representative, introduced me to Sonia a few minutes ago in the hotel dining room. Then came a telephone call for Schmidt-Pop. And now we're alone.
Don't move. Because I'm terrified. Please hold my hand tighter. I hate all this. It frightens me so. Blackness. Those horrible sirens, I...
Sonia is a well-traveled university graduate. She holds an important government position. She knows just about everything. Right now, she knows fear.
With 500,000 men in the Royal Navy, it is inevitable that there should be some coincidence of names and ranks between characters in this book and officers and ratings now serving. That is so inevitable that the author has made no attempt to avoid any such coincidence. All he can do is to assure the reader that he has attempted neither portrait nor caricature of any living person.
You'll find that written on one of the front pages of a book I read a few days ago. The Ship by C.S. Forrester. Words at War. The National Broadcasting Company, in cooperation with the Council on Books in Wartime, brings you another in its series of radio adaptations of great books of this war. Each week at this time, we bring you selected dramatic episodes from some of the most stirring of our war-inspired literature. Tonight's story...
Many of the American correspondents and radio men are in and around the hotel this Sunday morning. There's several of us coming and going on one mission or another. I remember Lee White. I remember Russell Hill of the New York Herald Tribune. I remember Ray Brock of the New York Times.
There they are! Nazi bombers!
That's Brock standing with me on the hotel balcony. Yes, there they are. 40 Nazi bombers, 2 miles up and coming over fast. We must go to the hotel lobby now and stand there like sheep staring into each other's faces. Stand there like sheep waiting for the slaughter. There's no dugout in the cellar. Belgrade was going to be declared an undefended city if war ever came. But the bombers are here. Nobody's had time to make any declarations. Ray Brock and I go downstairs. The symphony begins. The symphony of slaughter. This is the first and only movement. Full and terrible without a single solo instrument. Bombers moving forward, bombers diving, bombs falling, bombs bursting, anti-aircraft guns, pom-pom guns, machine guns, buildings cracking, buildings falling. Somewhere under it all must be the screams of defenseless dead and dying men and women and children. But these are the little voices in the symphony of slaughter, not warriors, but lovers of peace, little people. Let me speak for them. Let me shout above it all for this one moment. Let me proclaim...
Ship's on fire aft, sir.
Yes?
Pretty badly, apparently, sir.
Very good, Jernigan. Thank you.
One turret was out, but the A and B turrets were firing away beautifully, all four guns in white-hot action. At that moment, a shell was fired from HMS Artemis, which changed the face of the war, altered the whole history of the world. Men and women in Nigeria or Czechoslovakia would feel the impact of that shell upon their lives. Headhunting cannibals in Papua, Siberian nomads seeking a scant living on the frozen tundra of Asia, toddling babies in the cornfields of Iowa, and their children's children would all, in years to come, owe something to that shell. Of the four shells fired in that salvo, three of them missed. The fourth, the shell from the left-hand gun in turret A, hit. Later, the captain's report read,
"The enemy turned away, and the action terminated."
That shell hadn't done any particular damage when it hit the Italian Majesty's battleship Lignano, but the dual Italian-German command of Sein, Capitan Circe Helmuth von Bordica and Vice Admiraglio Gaspara Gaetano Nocentini, were hesitating about what to do with a pesky little British ship. And they were arguing.
Gunner there.
Gunnery up, sir.
We shall be opening fire again in 2 minutes.
And Artemis was already keeling over on the turn as she plunged back into the smoke screen to seek out her enemies once more.
1 minute.
Every man of the ship knew that the better he did his work now, the better would be his chance of life.
5 seconds. 2 minutes.
Guns ready. Open fire.
And the above torque roared its tons of steel again toward the eye tide. Artemis was shooting superbly. The captain could see that with his own eyes as he turned his binoculars upon the Italian flagship. The enemy salvos were creeping closer. It was nearly time to retire again. A mile away, another British ship, HMS Hera, had emerged from the smoke screen, spitting fire from all her turrets. With Hera out of the screen and the other cruisers beginning to show beyond her, it was for Artemis to withdraw and leave the Italians to their weary task of getting the range on these new elusive targets.
Port 10!
And Artemis plunged back into the protecting smoke. Then it happened. Salvos had been fired at Artemis without scoring a hit. Now, when she was invisible in the smoky, would all in years to come owe something to that shell. Of the four shells fired in that salvo, three of them missed. The fourth, the shell from the left-hand gun in turret A, hit. Later, the captain's report read,
"The enemy turned away, and the action terminated."
That shell hadn't done any particular damage when it hit the Italian Majesty's battleship Lignano, but the dual Italian-German command of Sein, Capitan Circe Helmuth von Bordica and Vice Admiraglio Gaspara Gaetano Nocentini, were hesitating about what to do with a pesky little British ship. And they were arguing, politely, of course, on points of strategy. Also, they were suspicious of one another and, well, you know how it is with the Italians and the Germans. The main thing is that when that historical 6-inch shell struck full upon their B turret and burst against the 12-inch steel, it became the deciding factor that tipped down the scale and swayed the balance of von Bordica's and Nocentini's hesitating minds.
The enemy turned away, and the action terminated.
The enemy's out of range, sir.
Thank you, Guns.
I believe I saw a torpedo hit on the second ship while you were speaking, sir.
Thank you.
Congratulations, sir.
Music was written and conducted by Frank Black. The production was under the direction of Joseph Losey. This program has been presented in cooperation with the Council on Books in Wartime, for the National Broadcasting Company and the independent radio stations associated with the NBC network. This program came to you from New York. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
Words at War presents Robert St. John's from the Land of Silent People.
That is the proud national anthem sung in Yugoslavia until the Nazis came. That is the scream of a Yugoslav woman. She's not being molested. Her pain is mental. She's just remembered something that happened on Bloody Sunday in Belgrade in Yugoslavia.
Or presents Robert St. John's from the Land of Silent People.
That is the proud national anthem sung in Yugoslavia until the Nazis came. That is the scream of a Yugoslav woman. She's not being molested. Her pain is mental. She's just remembered something that happened on Bloody Sunday in Belgrade in Yugoslavia. That's the bomb that killed her husband. When she looked from a window of their house and saw him running across the square, disobeying the shouted orders of the soldiers and the police. The sight of a man being blown to pieces is a horrible thing to remember.
The National Broadcasting Company, in cooperation with the Council on Books in Wartime, presents the sixth in the series, Words at War. Tonight, offering a radio adaptation of Robert St. John's great book, From the Land of Silent People.
Exactly 4 minutes, the enemy shot up suddenly over the curve of the world, climbing over it with astonishing speed.
Port 15, revolution for 27 knots.
Port 15,
revolutions for 27 knots.
Visibility was at its best. The enemy ships made hard, sharp silhouettes against the blue and gray background. Paymaster Sub-Lieutenant James Jerningham knew himself to be a coward. But some time ago, he made up his mind to be a coward lacking in nothing. He spent hours in his cabin, carefully studying the pictured profiles of hostile ships. Study carried out in a mood of desperation, of despair. And he had a photographic memory which enabled him to recall the very pages on which he had seen those profiles, even the very print beneath them.
The two leading ships are heavy cruisers, Bolzano, sir. 9,000 tons, 8 8-inch guns, 32 knots.
You're sure? Aren't they?
No, sir. And the last three cruisers look like Bandoneri's. I don't know about the first one, though, sir. She's like nothing we've been told about. I suppose she's the new one, Cadorna, and the intelligence people didn't get her profile right.
I expect you're right.
I think I am, sir.
Out of 500 who started as naval cadets, only one man ever reached the lofty rank of a captain RN. Only a few grades lower than God. That's the thought Jerningham had at that particular moment.
This evening we presented The Ship by C.S. Forrester. The script was written by Edmund Bernbrier of the NBC script staff. Next week you'll hear Robert St. John's book, From the Land of Silent People. The narrator tonight was played by Alan Bunce. House Jameson was the captain. Other members of the cast were Victor Beecroft, Sid Cassell, Humphrey Davis, Ian MacAllister, Shirley Oliver, and Alfred Shirley. The original music was written and conducted by Frank Black. The production was under the direction of Joseph Losey. This program has been presented in cooperation with the Council on Books in Wartime, for the National Broadcasting Company, and the independent radio stations associated with the NBC network. This program came to you from New York. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
Words at War presents Robert St. John's from the Land of Silent People.
I was so weak I could hardly walk to the Colonel's hotel, but finally I made it. And I was taken to his suite. A room with chairs to sit in.
And food.
Will you have another sandwich, Miss Du?
I've had 11 already.
Then have a piece of pastry.
I'll have another sandwich first, now I'll have a piece of pastry.
Oh, certainly.
Thank you.
Now, tell me, Miss Du, you are probably wondering why I invited you here today. Are you not?
Well, yes, I was, Colonel Tata.
It is very simple. I admire courage. I was very much impressed that day when you took our photographs. You did not show fear. So, I thought, sometime I will see this American newspaper woman. We will talk together.
So you're giving me an interview, Colonel Tata?
I can afford to. You are my prisoner.
All right, then. If this is an interview, here's a question. What does Japan hope to gain by this war? Even if she won, most of her navy would be gone, her buildings destroyed.
Even so. In the meantime, Japan will have taken all the resources of 1,000,000 miles of land, Malaya and its rubber, which your country needs so badly. Its chrome, the oil from East India, and so on and so on.
But what about your men? 1,000,000 of your men will be dead.
Miss Du, you Americans lose sight of our physiology and psychology. And the American fleet was practically destroyed at Pearl Harbor.
Pearl Harbor? Colonel Tata, I'm afraid Americans will never forgive you for striking while your ambassadors were still in the White House talking peace.
Oh, yes, I know, I know. But there is the way it had to be done. You can win a war in only one way. Destroy the enemy before he destroys you. Miss Du, we leave Europe to Germany. For the rest of the world, we are the new masters. And now, Miss Du, you must leave me. Oh, as a token of my kindness, I ask you to accept this jar of jam.
P.S. I took the jam.
I told you, Miss Du, you ought to leave. I told you. And you just kept saying there's going to be a war and you wanted to see the balloon go up.
And it did, didn't it, Sergeant? The balloon went up all right. I just didn't think the blooming thing would come down.
Now, now, Miss Du. Tears from such as you. I am surprised, Miss Du. Now, now, we'll be all right.
From the hotel, we were taken to a large internment camp. It was crowded and filthy, and we still had the same starvation diet. We set up a sort of primitive housekeeping.
Drugstore for pills. They say he got very bad pain in his head.
Evan. We're dead, Evan. You hear me? We're dead. We're in hell. This isn't Greece. This is hell.
Ladies and gentlemen, may we reintroduce in person the distinguished author of the book, From the Land of Silent People, Mr. Robert St. John.
I called them silent people because as I fled from Europe, I knew that the vast majority of those people would be silent for a few years as they suffered and starved under Nazi domination, waiting for the light. But not completely silent. Bands of guerrillas in both Yugoslavia and in Greece, for more than 2 years now, have been harassing the enemy. And tonight I can imagine the new hope which surges through the breasts of those occupied millions. I know how they get their news over there, over hidden clandestine radio receivers, by whispered word of mouth. The news that the Tommies and the Doughboys have cleaned the Axis out of Africa, that the Tommies and the Doughboys have landed in Sicily, that Rome has been bombed, that the Russians are closing in on Orgel, that 1,000...
You are my prisoner.
All right, then. If this is an interview, here's a question. What does Japan hope to gain by this war? Even if she won, most of her navy would be gone, her buildings destroyed...
Even so. In the meantime, Japan will have taken all the resources of 1,000,000 miles of land, Malaya and its rubber, which your country needs so badly. Its chrome, the oil from East India, and so on and so on.
But what about your men? 1,000,000 of your men will be dead.
Miss Du, you Americans lose sight of our physiology and psychology. We would rather die for Japan than live for her. From the battlefield, white boxes of ashes are sent home for the family shrines. Don't forget, Mr. We Japanese do not think of this war in the terms of this year or next. We think of the future history of Japan. You know how one white race after another, the Greeks, the Romans, the French, have risen and then declined. The past belonged to these white races. But the future belongs to us. Soon the whole world will be speaking Japanese.
You talk as if the war were already won, Colonel Tara.
Oh, Japan is already the second largest empire in the world. And the America...
The promise of victory and peace and freedom.
We present in person the author of Prisoner of the Japs, Gwen Du.
Some of us came home, but 150,000 Allied soldiers and civilians are still prisoners of the Japs. Tonight we have tried to tell you what that means. We have forced ourselves to speak of those days so that you may understand Japan. She has taken 1 million square miles of territory, and we have won back 200 square miles. Perhaps if you can remember what we have said tonight, it will help us to crush Japan's new empire before the friends we had to leave have died, prisoners of the Japs.
You have heard the seventh program of Words at War, a series based on the leading war books. This evening, we presented Prisoners of the Japs by Gwen Du. The adaptation was by Nora Sterling of the NBC script staff. Next week, you'll hear a...
Boat of ours, the Makadanka.
Yeah, what about the Makadanka?
Well, she's just a 20-foot sardine boat. She's just got a one-cylinder outboard engine, a sail, and four oars in case.
All of that. What of it?
Well... Now we've got Terry Atherton of the London Daily Mail with us. And besides you and me, there's Kay of United Press, Lee White.
So?
You in love with Sonia, Bob?
Don't talk nonsense. Of course not.
Well, the Makadonk is nothing more than a rowboat, Bob. Now, to make a getaway, we've got to go hundreds of miles down the Adriatic, down the coast of Yugoslavia, Albania, until we hit the Greek mainland somewhere, or the Greek island of Corfu. A part of that time, we'll be snug between the heel of Italy and Albania. We've got no food.
A long sea voyage in an overgrown rowboat. No food. If we do get picked up by the Italian Navy, it'll be a lot tougher for her than us.
Well?
Hey, you're right. Sonia can't go with us. I left Yugoslavia that night with a lot of pictures indelibly stamped in my mind. Pictures of dead bodies in the square in Belgrade, mangled bodies in Sarajevo when the bombs came there. Crowds of bewildered people in Budva waiting for the bombs to come. But one of the clearest...
...than war. Perhaps mankind will pass that test when the time comes. As for me, when that time comes, I will fight to the last. Die in the last ditch. Before I will compromise in the slightest with the blind or secret enemies of freedom and justice. You have heard the seventh program of Words at War, a series based on the great books of this war. This evening we presented The Ship by C.S. Forrester. The script was written by Edmund Bernbrier of the NBC script staff. Next week you'll hear Robert St. John's book, From the Land of Silent People. The narrator tonight was played by Alan Bunce.
House Jameson was the captain. Other members of the cast were Victor Beecroft, Sid Cassell, Humphrey Davis, Ian McAllister, Shirley Oliver, and Alfred Shirley. The original music was written and conducted by Frank Black. The production was under the direction of Joseph Losey.
We can walk past the park. There are spring flowers now. And the good, clean, fresh air. So nice.
Yeah, for how long? Next week, that clean, fresh air may smell of gunpowder and burning buildings and burning people.
No. No, it must not be. But whatever comes, you have promised me on your honor to take me with you when you leave Belgrade. You must write down my telephone number also. Now.
All right. And speaking of telephones, I must take you home and get back to my rooms upstairs. I'm expecting a call from Switzerland, perhaps from the United States.
America? In war? You can talk to America? How wonderful! How perfectly wonderful!
St. John speaking.
Berlin calling.
Berlin?
Associated Press, Berlin.
AP Berlin?
Oui, monsieur, that is correct.
Oui, monsieur, that is correct. Oh, so, so, so correct. What are you doing tonight, St. John?
I was just thinking of bed. So what? You got a little party on up there?
Seriously, St. John, if I were you, I wouldn't go to bed tonight. So long.
Hey, hey, wait a minute. Why shouldn't I go to bed?
Oh, I don't have any idea. We think up here...
Yeah. Oh, we don't need to worry about that. Hong Kong's an impenetrable fortress. Has been for 100 years.
But this is 1941.
Hong Kong Airport has been destroyed. All planes smashed. All naval installations are under artillery bombardment. Japan is at war with Hong Kong.
Words at War. Tonight, the National Broadcasting Company, in cooperation with the Council on Books in Wartime, brings you another in its series of radio adaptations of important books of this war. Each week, selected episodes are dramatized from some of the most stirring of our war-inspired literature. Tonight, we hear the story of an American newspaper woman who happened to be in Hong Kong on the day the Japanese attacked. The book is Prisoner of the Japs. The author is Gwen Dew.
Monday, December 8th, 1941, was to have been my last day in Hong Kong. I'd planned...
With 500,000 men in the Royal Navy, it is inevitable that there should be some coincidence of names and ranks between characters in this book and officers and ratings now serving. That is so inevitable that the author has made no attempt to avoid any such coincidence. All he can do is to assure the reader that he has attempted neither portrait nor caricature of any living person.
You'll find that written on one of the front pages of a book I read a few days ago. The Ship by C.S. Forrester. Words at War. The National Broadcasting Company, in cooperation with the Council on Books in Wartime, brings you another in its series of radio adaptations of great books of this war. Each week at this time, we bring you selected dramatic episodes from some of the most stirring of our war-inspired literature. Tonight's story, The Ship, by C.S. Forrester.
The way it had to be done. You can win a war in only one way. Destroy the enemy before he destroys you. Miss Dew, we leave Europe to Germany. For the rest of the world, we are the new masters. And now, Miss Dew, you must leave me. Oh, as a token of my kindness, I ask you to accept this jar of jam.
P.S. I took the jam.
I told you, Miss Dew, you ought to leave. I told you. And you just kept saying there's going to be a war and you wanted to see the balloon go up.
And it did, didn't it, Sergeant? The balloon went up all right. I just didn't think the blooming thing had come down.
Now, Miss Dew. Tears from such as you. I am surprised, Miss Dew. Now, we'll be all right.
From the hotel, we were taken to a large internment camp. It was crowded and filthy, and we still had the same starvation diet. We set up a sort of primitive housekeeping. Everyone had duties, cooking, washing, sanitation. By now, we'd been prisoners 6 months. There was one thing that kept us from despair. We'd heard rumors that there was to be an exchange of prisoners, so many Americans for so many Japs. No one knew who the lucky ones were.
The government that sold Yugoslavia to Hitler and Mussolini. Simovich is playing a dangerous game, and he knows it. But he'll fight. Fight against a necklace of steel around Yugoslavia's neck. Italian troops on the northwest, Italian troops in Albania. Nazi troops, Nazi planes, Nazi tanks lined up along the Romanian, Bulgarian, and Hungarian frontiers. In Belgrade, the people cheer and sing the Yugoslavian national anthem. The will to fight Nazi tyranny is alive and singing in Yugoslavia. This April of 1941. The means to fight have not been found wanting. Not yet. In Belgrade, Simovich reforms the government, stalls for time, orders the German legation to leave Yugoslavia.
Well, St. John, nice of you to see us off.
Tell me, do any of Herr Hitler's representatives remain in Belgrade?
By tomorrow morning, there won't be a single German left in Yugoslavia, except our military attaché and his assistant, and their two servants. They'll be ready for anything.
What is anything likely to mean?
No matter. Cheer up, St. John. We'll be back soon, we Germans. Probably very soon. And when we do come, we'll bring a few souvenirs. Bye, St. John. Take care.
Take care. Spoken like a warning. Or perhaps a command.